So, My Hero Academia, Manga Chapter 300 has been translated, and it's sad to say this, but Endeavor is dead. The spoilers were true. Rest in peace, Endeavor. You will be missed. Let's get into the chapter. Hey guys, how's it going? It is your boy, Big Blue Drew 97 here, and today we are going to be talking about My Hero Academia Manga Chapter 300. Yes, we have reached this milestone finally. This is, relatively speaking, a big chapter. When it comes to this actual chapter, not like a whole lot, like big explosions or something like that occurs, but based from the title that we have of this chapter of chapter 300, which is The Hellish Todoroki Family 2, I think that title gives away what a lot of this chapter is going to be about. And when it comes to this chapter, it's actually mostly broken up into two parts, and I'll get to that more into the review. And before we actually get into the review, I'd like to ask you, if you haven't done so, to subscribe to my YouTube channel, BigBlueDrew97. If you like seeing and watching these reviews, leave a like and comment down below. Without the way, let's get right into the review, because I'm very excited to talk about this chapter. Like I said at the beginning, this chapter can be broken up into two major parts. The second part, which will take up most of this chapter, is really Endeavor and the Todoroki family just coming together to basically begin to talk and understand everything that's going on with Toya, while with the first part, we're actually getting more fallout for everything that happened within the span of the 2 days after the incident with Shigaraki and after these prisoners were escaped. We get a better understanding of like where Hero Society and just society as a whole is going. And something important that we have to realize is that the first words that is most likely translated, because these aren't the official translations, but from what we have with these translations, it says, "The city has fallen into panic." That just shows, that in itself shows like where this story is going to be going, and even more so in this chapter, where society is coming, because we get this little monologue, or we get basically a lot of this exposition about how Hero Society is crumbling and how many of the people in the society were on edge because they realized, oh yeah, all of these villains have escaped, but they also came to the realization that no moves were real. And this is very important because tying back into the pro hero arc with Endeavor and Hawks, Hawks had this little monologue to Endeavor about how many of the civilians heard rumors about Nomu at UA and how many of them were afraid about that. And we all thought that, oh, it's just rumors. And we all thought that that might have been a lie from Hawks to get Endeavor to be attacked by Hood. But in actuality, those rumors were of the people. They were scared. They were afraid of these monsters. And now that they realize that they are real, they are terrified. And the fact of the matter is that these monsters are real, and that the heroes that they thought were going to protect them couldn't even really defeat them. This just shows that, yeah, the civilians are just in a state of panic and they don't know what to do. And a good visual that they have in this chapter is how you have just a glass cup of water that can represent society and the feelings that they have for it. And after the incident 2 days ago, that cup just shatters and the water goes everywhere. Basically, society is just crumbled, it's shattered, it's destroyed. And what is even more interesting is that we actually get a callback not just to the pro hero arc, but also sort of to the provisional license exam, as well as like where Bakugo as well as Shoto, how they were able to get their provisional license. Because after this exposition of like how a society is crumbling, we get to see a familiar face, and it is one of the people from, if I remember correctly, from the Cedar House gang. And apparently they were broken out most likely by All For One, and now they're causing havoc in this city. But what is even more amazing is that while they're causing this havoc, a random civilian coming up with support items is going to go and fight them. And from here, this is where we get more understanding of like how the civilians are also reacting to everything that happened at the a few days ago, where an entire city was basically destroyed by villains, as well as we get more understanding of like how many civilians have just lost hope in the heroes, because they've come to this realization like, hey, if the heroes aren't here to help, like, like, we have to defend ourselves. And from here, I think we kind of get like a monologue or the inner thoughts of Wash, because we see Wash is on the scene. He is warned that these gang members are destroying this city and that he's going to help. And we get more context and understanding of what Reed Destro meant when he said that he had sown these seeds, which would be how civilian, and also how he predicted that civilians would begin fighting for themselves against the villains without the hero's help. And we see exactly that happening. And I think this is from where we get a transition from the monologue from Reed Destro's side to more of the monologue for Wash's side, because he begins to think that, yeah, they're going to bring up these weapons to attack these villains, but the problem is these civilians haven't been trained, and that it could cause a lot more damage than like if it was just a normal hero. Where Wash arrives on the scene, they have multiple buildings being destroyed, many civilians were caught in the crossfire, and this is all, and apparently this isn't just like a singular incident. This, something like this is happening around the country of Japan. So it's not just in just one area. It's literally the entire country. Every civilian that thinks that they can fight back against the villains is trying to fight back, which is causing more damage, which is getting more civilians involved. And what is even more ironic is that even when the hero comes to try to help, when Wash comes to help, the people are like saying like, we don't need your help because of these heroes. Like, you say that we should stay indoors, but look, even if we stay indoors, we still get hurt. And I'm just thinking like, well, yeah, but the point of them keeping you inside is so that you don't like potentially die. It's safer to be inside when there are like villains on the loose than it is to be out in the open. And I guess what is like really telling is that even though like we can view that as like, yeah, that's a stupid idea, within the world, it wouldn't make sense to them, because they've always had these ideas of heroes protecting them. And like the single moment where it's like, oh, one hero like messes up, or like with this one big incident that all these heroes mess up, yeah, we can't trust heroes anymore. But it's not just the one incident that makes the civilians not trust heroes, because even after all of this, even though Wash gets like a frying pan thrown at his head, he still attempts to take all of the injured to the hospital. We get even more understanding of like not just how one hero is being affected and how one resignation of a hero is affecting all of society, but how we get the realization that multiple heroes begin retiring, because we get to see one of the top 10 heroes, one of the pro heroes, the samurai guy, number 9 hero, Yori Musha. He announces his retirement, which means that one of the top 10 heroes, after all of this is happening, is deciding to retire, which many people, from what we see, are angry about. It. They're like, what are you doing? You talked about how you're going to commit suicide, but you're not going to go through with it. What's wrong with you? Come on, everything is worse. You won't take responsibility. And the guy's like, no, I just don't want to do this. And from here, we also get the realization and revelation that he's not the only hero that retired. Like, after this incident, after what happened with Shigaraki, what happened with the League of Villains, what happened with the Paranormal Liberation Front, many heroes began to resign. And that this idea of peace with these heroes that many of the civilians knew about is beginning to crumble, and they begin to question the meaning of what a hero is. Which is very important because of two things. One, we see All Might statue where he's like, I am not here, which ties more into Endeavor and his story. But we also get to see another particular individual that had these ideas that heroes aren't heroes, especially the heroes that we have now, because we cut over to Stain, where he begins to get into this store. He begins grabbing a sword, implying that he's about to go on his hero crusade once again, meaning that he's probably going to try to attempt to kill a lot more of these so-called heroes, which basically, yeah, what Stain was saying was technically right. So like, even though he was killing these fake heroes, saying that these weren't real heroes, that All Might was the only true hero, yeah, he wasn't wrong, which is interesting. Like, he went around about it the wrong way, but exactly what he's saying, he was exactly right, because if these people were truly heroes, then they wouldn't just simply retire when things got tough. Like many heroes, All Might, like Deku, put their lives on the line, even if it means that they die, and many of these quote heroes aren't willing to do that. So yeah, Stain's philosophy is technically correct, and it's kind of confirmed in this chapter, which is amazing, because yeah, the so-called villain is right, or at least with Stain, yeah. It's just weird to think about that. Just think about that. The villain of a story's philosophy is right. And what is very interesting is that this is just showing that, yeah, the villain was right, Stain was right, but now we're probably going to get, like, really, like, he's right, but what are we going to do about it? Like, how are we going to get real heroes? And I think that's going to tie into the UA kids, how they're going to be heroes for more altruistic means, being heroes for the sake of helping people instead of being heroes for, like, monetary benefit, because it's, like, a cushy lifestyle, because now people are realizing, hey, being a hero isn't everything that we thought it was. It's actually really dangerous, and you have to basically want to be a hero, not for the gain, but because you actually want to help people, which is something that Stain would view as being true heroism. And now we get to the second part of this chapter, where we're going to be tackling the Todoroki family. And something I wanted to bring up is that when I was talking about how with All Might, how many of the civilians are blaming the heroes for everything that happened, that is not exactly accurate. They are blaming the heroes for everything that is happening. The civilians are losing faith in the heroes, but the problem is they're all putting the blame, they're all putting the burden on one hero, on the shoulders of one hero in particular. They're blaming one hero for everything that has happened, and that hero is Endeavor, which, this is interesting because this just shows more and more how flawed the hero society is, and how civilians and how hero society viewed heroes, particularly in Japan, because they viewed that, oh yeah, hero society will be stable with a single person. If All Might was still here, All Might could have stopped this, All Might could have done this, All Might could have done that. That's probably going through the eyes of the people, and they're thinking like, oh yeah, once Endeavor came, like, all of this bad stuff started happening, this and this and this, it's all because of Endeavor, when in actuality, it has been like this the entire time. All For One has always been out there. All For One has always been controlling everything behind the backgrounds. The only reason why the civilians don't know about that is because All Might hid that. All Might chose to be that one pillar of peace, tying into, like, why their hero society is completely flawed. Their over-reliance on one hero in All Might could be considered, like, the catalyst in the inevitability of this happening. And because that's all that they've known, when someone tries to replace them in that instance, they have to blame that person because that's all they've known. If they've seen that only one person can hold up here society, and they're the reason why they have peace, if they see someone else trying to hold up here society and they fail, they're going to blame it on him. So yeah, Endeavor is being blamed for all of this. And frankly, he kind of believes it, because from this second part of the chapter, Endeavor begins to wake up. But then, once again, you have Endeavor, and you have this doctor who looks like Toad from the Mario series. So we had Toad this chapter, and then we had someone that looked like Yoshi last chapter. Yoshi! So it's very interesting to see Hirokoshi wear pop culture on his sleeve. But from here, we basically get to see Endeavor. He's waking up. He's beginning to remember everything that happened over the past few days. He's beginning to gain consciousness, and he's feeling like a whole lot of guilt and a whole lot of burden. Mainly because he realized that he couldn't stop Dobby. He couldn't stop his son, and that he froze up while his other son tried and fight with all of his might. And he's becoming to realize that even if everything that Dobby said became, like, untrue because of the single inconsistency with Best Genius, he realizes that it doesn't matter. That everything that has happened in his life is coming and building to this point. Every horrible thing that he did to his children, every horrible thing that he did to Toya, every horrible action or bad attitude that he had his entire life is coming and boiling up to this point. And he's come to the realization that, yeah, Endeavor, the hero, is dead. Even though Inji Todoroki survived, Endeavor is dead. So yeah, technically, Endeavor, as the hero, is dead in the eyes of Inji Todoroki, because Endeavor was this persona. Endeavor was the hero that tried to achieve number one, who pushed his sons to the brink of, like, exhaustion and potential death. That person is dead, and that he realizes that he could not kill his son, even though he's a mass murderer, even though heroes are supposed to stop him. He physically cannot do that, as we see that Endeavor begins to break down crying. And then Shoto shows up with, like, probably the best, like, what face as he closes the door. Endeavor screams, Shoto, as he tells his family that Endeavor is crying, as we get to see, like, Natsu, Fuyumi coming in. Fuyumi's like, yeah, hey, Dad. Yeah, we're all okay. Yeah, it's we just got here all together. Yeah, it's really weird. And even Natsu's, like, begins to chime in. It's like, why are you crying? As we see Endeavor's just crying once again, how he's apologizing, he's sorry, he regrets everything, he has so much this regret, all this guilt just inside of him, he's so sorry, and that his heart is, but then someone chimes in talking about, like, what about your heart, as we get the reveal that, yes, the person that was with Fuyumi and Natsu was their mother, Rei, as Rei begins to chime in with the last part of this chapter. It's like, yeah, your regret, your guilt, yeah, everyone's got it. Everyone's carrying it, pretty much more than you. And Endeavor is, like, so confused, like, what are you doing here, Rei? Why are you here? Why? And she just says that, yeah, I'm here to talk about our family and Toya. As the chapter ends, and oh my gosh. This was a great chapter for My Hero Academia. So, for starters, first of all, we get a lot more context for how Hero Society is crumbling and how the war with the villains versus the heroes, how that war has basically shifted and changed society for the worst. The civilians, the society has lost hope in heroes. Civilians are beginning to fight all of, like, these worries and concerns that they had about Nomu eventually boiled up to the point where they think that, yeah, heroes aren't, like, worthy. Heroes weren't here to help us. We have to help ourselves, which led to more destruction, which shows that, yeah, even though, like, y'all are losing hope in heroes, y'all are still civilians. Like, at least, like, the worst hero there has more training than the average civilian to try and prevent, like, all these bad things from happening. Because as we've seen with other people, specifically with Gentle, that, yeah, the reason why civilians can't use their quirks to help other people is because they haven't been trained and they can do more harm than good. And we've seen that more in this chapter, how these civilians with these support gears just destroyed their entire, like, buildings, destroyed entire streets, leaving people extremely injured. Even the villains themselves were extremely injured. And when a hero came to help, they shooed him away. They threw stuff at him saying, like, yo, this is all y'all fault. Even though the civilians were the ones that enacted, and that's because of their over-reliance on the hero system. But it's not just the hero system, it's also the people that were also heroes that we've seen are also extremely flawed. How we have literally the number 9 hero beginning to retire, and it's not because, like, he didn't think that he could do the job, he just doesn't want to, and he gets backlash for that, as well as just showing, like, how flawed this hero society was, because it was built on the back of a single person, and how if a single person tries to replace them, they get blamed for anything that bad happens because of, like, how conditioned the society has been when it comes to heroes, and how they thought that they were always good and how they were always great if there was only one person doing it. And it just shows that one person cannot hold up hero society, as well as we get a lot more development from Endeavor, as well as we're most likely, if not next chapter, within sometime in the future, we're gonna get more of the Todoroki family beginning to connect. They may be building more bonds, they may be coming together, and they may not technically forgive everything that Endeavor has done, but at the very least, what Dobby did, what he thought he was gonna do, was kill Endeavor and destroy Hero Society, but the side effect that he didn't think was going to happen is that he's actually bringing the Todoroki family closer together, and that's really amazing, showing that even though Dobby's plan technically succeeded, it had a side effect that he probably would have never have expected because of all of the malice that Dobby has. So it's going to be very interesting to see the development and the connections that Endeavor is going to rebuild with his family, and see, like, how this is going to affect Todoroki, because from what we've seen in this chapter, yeah, the person that's most likely going to take out Dobby is going to be Todoroki. And even just the idea that Endeavor is dead, yeah, the hero of Endeavor is dead, but most likely the Inji Todoroki is going to be reborn as a new person. He may even take on a new hero persona. We just don't know. He may retire. He may still even be technically the hero Endeavor, but a new Endeavor, as the old Endeavor died in the Paranormal Liberation Front, and a new Endeavor will take his place. We just don't know, but there's so many things that you can really like speculate from this chapter that just having one video, one review will not do it justice. So with that, I'm gonna have to cut this video now. I want to go on and on, but I think this video is getting too long as it is. So hopefully you enjoyed this review. Hopefully you enjoyed my ramblings of this chapter, the review, and if you did, leave a like down below. Talk about what you liked about this chapter. What do you think this is going? It's chapter 300. Where do you think that we're gonna go from here? Where do you think the story is gonna go from this point on? Because I think that what's most likely gonna happen is that we're gonna have the students being more active in the hero roles, and how little by little the heroes at UA are going to be changing Hero Society's perspective on heroes, coming to the realization that yeah, there are still going to be heroes out there, and this may change like what type of people become heroes, and potentially some of the kids at UA may leave because they may also come to a similar realization as these pro heroes that heroism, being a hero, may not be for them. So leave your thoughts down below, leave a like, leave a comment, subscribe to my YouTube channel, do all of that cool jazz, and hopefully I'll be able to catch you in my next video. Goodbye!